These items on the display here are values. It's a value of a PI tag. It's simply showing us a current value, and it's only showing the value, not the timestamp or the tag name. And those are options that we're going to add right now. So let's go into a brand new display, and let's add some values. As we've done before, we can start by going into build mode and going into the data favorites and switching this over to specify value. And what this does is it simply allows us to drag these over and create value objects. You double click on them, you'll see the builder screen. And let me delete these, and I'll just go ahead and create a value from scratch. I'll close the data favorites now. You can go into draw, and within draw there's an option called value. That's the same as you'll see on this button, this little 1, 2, 3 button. Click here, and then click at the location where you want the button to appear. Now that's very important. Let me just make a point of this. I'll draw a little intersection here. Here's a line, here's another line. And watch where the value appears when I position my cursor. I'm going to position my cursor right here at the intersection. Now that's going to be, if I remember correctly, I believe that's the bottom left corner the bottom left corner of the value. Let's see if I'm correct. Top left corner of the value. So that's where you're going to, when you're positioning these on the screen, that's how you'll find it. The top left corner is where your value will appear. Now that's going to be the same whether you put timestamps on it or not. That's always going to be the top left corner for positioning purposes. And as you can see, you can choose to put none of those or all of those. You can choose where you're going to put those. I can put them on the left, the right, the top, the bottom. End up with something like that. And you can choose to specify what the format is going to be of the number. So for example, let's put the tag name at the bottom, timestamp at the bottom. Using this preview, I can see what I'm going to get there. And I'm going to specify this as one decimal place. Now I would strongly recommend you carefully consider your decimal places. And there we go, the one decimal place. Yeah, nothing destroys the credibility of a system like PI quicker than when somebody shows, oh, I don't know, maybe it's a level transmitter that's at, 1/1000th of an inch accuracy. Anyway, so consider carefully what you choose for your numbering format here. Now, in addition, there is an option called database. Database will simply find whatever's been configured in the PI Point database for that tag. So by choosing database, it's essentially leaving it to whatever the system manager has configured. I'm going to set this up for one decimal place. There we go. Now because this is essentially a text object, if you do need to resize it, you'll notice that invoking just the regular resizing handles here, that's actually going to go ahead and launch the Windows convention for changing font size. So these are Windows part of the Windows standard, so that's how we choose to use these. And of course, all those other things associated with Windows objects are available as well. I can bold it, I can make it italics, I can underline it, etc. So this is these are the options that are available to you. Let me go ahead and switch this to 14 point. I wanted to make the point also that there are two colors associated with this. There's the line color and then there's the background color. So for the line color, that's essentially going to be the text. The background color is going to be the color that I'm using in the background. There we go. Okay, I'd like to do a quick summary of the three dynamic objects we've worked with already. We've worked with the trend, the bar graph, and the value so far. I'll create a brand new display, and I'll add this for sinusoid for each of those. And I think the easiest way to do it by far is to use the data favorites. So I'll go ahead and use data favorites. First, I'm going to set up a trend. I'll drag this over, drop it right there. Here's my trend. I can modify this as I need to by double-clicking. For example, put in the proper plot name, etc. The second thing I can do is let me add a bar graph. So I'll switch over to bar. Same thing, sinusoid, drag that over here, and then format it the way I want. I think I'll put that right about here. So it's going to track. Let's have it track exactly what the trend is doing. Yeah, let's make it the zero and span match what we see in the trend. And to do that, I'm going to change this to, instead of auto range, let's change this to database. Okay. So what we should see now as we scroll backward and forward is that value and the trend value should always parallel each other, and that's what we're seeing here. Okay. It kind of illustrates the point that the bar graph and the value are going to take the timestamp of whatever the end time of the trend is. Okay. Now, the last thing I'm going to do is add a value, so I'll go ahead and choose value. Bring sinusoid down here. It's going to take whatever configuration was most recent. In this case, it was that full configuration with the value, the tag name, and the timestamp underneath. Now, with this here, I certainly don't need to put that over here anymore, so I can get rid of the value. There we go. And the tag name. There we go. Now, just as with the bar graph, if I were to, let's say, for example, I were to zoom in here and then select nothing, as I scroll backward and forward on this, then all of the objects on here, including the value and the bar graph, they're all going to take the timestamp of the end time. So 331, 331, etc. Now, as a builder of these displays, one last thing you should consider is if you do have multiple trends on display, like let's go ahead and add a second trend here. I'll change the tag name to something else. If you've got multiple trends on the display, you may then wonder, okay, with two trends on here, which trend is going to be the kind of the anchor for the time span as we scroll backward and forward? And the point I wanted to make is that it's the trend that's on the lowest part of the redrawing order. So let me put this trend right here. See, if I were to now zoom in on this trend and then select nothing, as I scroll, you may wonder, you know, which end time are we using? As you can see, it's the end time of the trend that's on the lowest on the redrawing order. That's because that ends up being the first trend. So we need to choose something. We choose the first trend, which is likely to be the one that's lowest on the redrawing order. So that becomes the anchor point, you know, kind of the decider for whose end time is used for the bar graphs and the values.